Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 26. How Help Comes About for Mind Control Victims. Continues. How the Mind Creates a Programmed Reality. The idea of consciousness versus subconscious are difficult to describe but are fundamental to how the programming works. What mental activity is occurring in the mind of an individual? Most mental activity is unconscious. Many of our activities in life are done unconsciously. If our attention is directed somewhere else, we can perform an activity without a conscious awareness. Some mental activity surfaces from the subconscious. Daydreaming has been recognized as beneficial in a person's well-being. Delinquent teenage boys have been found to seldom daydream. The mental activity of thoughts, emotions, perceptions, and memories are all embedded into the mind. The structures of the mind are built by thoughts and emotions. A chaotic jumble of impressions is organized by the mind into something cohesive and usable. Our minds fabricate a reality from our thoughts and emotions. The programmer steps into the picture and makes that reality, designing a team activity. Emotions, hallucinations, moods, phobias, sensory perceptions, trances, and visions are not part of cognitive conscious data-based knowledge, but are more like the ROM memory that runs a computer, which is permanent and untouchable. These are important foundational structures of thinking. They lay in the subconscious. The subconscious mind is like a cesspool. The subconscious mind accepts whatever has been allowed by the mind to reach it. Once something is accepted in, the subconscious mind doesn't evaluate it. That is why hypnosis and illusion are so powerful. Using hypnosis, the programmer can place an idea into the subconscious that would take long periods of time for the mind to naturally screen and then accept into the subconscious. Briefly described, thoughts and emotions create the mind's reality. The programmer wants to be able to tamper with how the mind's reality is created. The front alters, who hold the body day-to-day, will have to face the shortcomings of whoever is their system's programmer, cult leaders, or handler. For some slaves, say for instance Anton Lavey's or Michael Aquino's, their programmer is their cult leader and their handler, all three wrapped up in one individual. The victim's front alters will experience the shortcomings of their controller. Rather than fight against what the mind will see and hear, the programmer will reframe it. They want the front alters to see the human aspect. They want them to see the faults, but accept the weaknesses as a normal function of the humanness of the person. The faults are reframed as merely human frailty and negative external circumstances. Let's give an example. The victim is encouraged to think, yes, he drank, but so what? He was a social person and of course he had to drink. Yes, he made a mistake, but it was someone else's fault. The negatives of the programmer are reframed as natural positives by the programmer. The victim's mind will feel very comfortable with these rationales. This is an example of how the programmer has tampered with the mind's perception of reality. This tampering is part of the subtle hypnotic programming. Do the programmers do this type of subtle programming? Yes, it is a standard thing to place this refraining in to protect the father, daddy, and mother programmer images. As Illuminati programmers, we were taught to use thoughts, emotions, comfort, and discomfort to mold the mind's reality. The mind decides if it is in a state of comfort or discomfort. At some extreme point, the mind can do a reversal and decide that pain is pleasure. In such a reversal, the mind will move in the direction of comfort, i.e. pain. In our example, we are not describing such an extreme situation. It is quite normal for the mind to whitewash its image of an authority figure. This is an inborn natural comfort zone. Now let's say that a therapist wants to tamper with that programming. The therapist can attack the programming head-on by saying, "Your programmer was an evil man." But this approach plays into the hands of the programmer, whose manufactured reality will resist such a head-on approach. The therapist may want to use the backdoor approach to sidestep the resistance. The backdoor method prevents triggers. A backdoor approach might be: therapist, what would you have liked to have seen in the life of controller's name? Slave, I wish he would not have drank so much. Therapist, how did that affect you? Slave, I didn't get taken care of. The backdoor approach frees the victim from having to make a judgment call that the controller was right or wrong, good or evil. It makes the issue into an I issue, I would have liked. The victim doesn't have to step out too far from the mind's comfort zone. The victim's power ends where fear begins. At the point the victim begins to fear is where the victim gives the programmer power. This is a basic principle well known by Illuminati programmers. The programming is built upon this. Some children actually intuitively grasp methods to not fear the programmer. If the child does this, the child becomes harder to program, because a person's power ends where fear begins. At the point of powerlessness and fear, the world around the victim becomes more like a dream. Eventually, fear becomes a comfort zone for the victim. A visual representation of powerlessness is the teddy bear, who has no genitals, no hands, or feet. The teddy bear finds its way into our illustrated guidebook. Some therapists have found the visual images of the illustrated guidebook helpful. In the previous example, the victim at first will feel strange and uneasy to question their life. They are moving out of their comfort zone of simple existence into the life of choices. Many alters need help as they take their first wobbly steps toward freedom of thought and action. When fear enters the mind, perceptions of reality are altered. Fears can be conditioned into the mind. The programmers know how to introduce fears. Fear taps into the death circuits of the brain and activates death-related reflexes. The programmer is like the conductor of a symphony of fears, at one point orchestrating one area, at another point bringing another fear to a crescendo. The programmers know how the mind protects itself. The free will of the brain is orchestrated out of existence to the tune of dependence upon the programmer. The natural flow of how the mind perceives reality is drowned out under the influence of fear. The programmer can interrupt natural perceptions of reality by introducing fear. The fear creates fragments in the mind, and denials in the mind. In the end, the victim of programming has pieces of reality that appear out of nowhere and seem unconnected and like a dream. Is fear bad? When a person is stripped of trust in God and man, where do they turn? Fear seems comfortable to the victim, who cannot say nothing ventured, nothing gained, I'll walk right through this situation. The instinct of the brain is to run toward its image of comfort, fear. How does the victim rise above the fear? There are ways, but they generally involve the victim getting outside help. The therapist will want to stay one step ahead of fear. Different people will have different kinds of fear. Males are born wanting to be protective and strong. They are designed to face the outside world and lovingly protect. The programmers break their male identity. They are stripped of it when they see that they are powerless to protect other children and powerless to protect themselves. They further feel unprotected by their mothers when they are tortured as infants. This brings in a strong sense of rejection. They know they are weak and helpless. Their inborn desire to want to lovingly protect is destroyed, because they develop the subconscious attitude that love can't protect. Because love can't protect, these men become hardened. At the root of their hardness, is the fear that they can't love, accepted by the subconscious through their inability to lovingly protect, nor are they worthy of love, built in by their feeling rejected of their mom's loving protection. Once the subconscious attitude is accepted that they can't love nor be loved, they die emotionally. They run from emotions because of a subconscious awareness of the trauma. When men run from their emotions, they find it natural to tap into their intellect. In summary, the male is born to have strength to protect what it loves. When traumatized, the male feels helpless, and develops a fear of love and emotion. Love becomes a negative to subconsciously run from. The programmer only needs to tap into the mind's own methods to protect itself. The mind will protect the programming much better than the programmer ever could. After fear is well established as a foundation, the programming team will layer in with repetition the no talk, no see, no hear messages over and over. they will repeat, do nothing to hurt the family. Family means the Illuminati, or at times another cult. If left to its own devices, the mind has the ability to sort things out, and write itself. The programmers are fully aware of how the mind might write itself, and pull itself out of the programmer's lies. The Illuminati teach their programmers not to let the conscious become conscious, not to let the intellect become intellect, and not to let love become love. What this means is that what consciously happens in external reality, is not permitted to be internalized as conscious reality. The programming tricks to prevent this could fill a book, and many are mentioned in our Volume 2 Formula book. Love becomes love when the self knows the true self. Therefore, the task of the programmer becomes to hide the true self from the mind. Some of the greatest philosophers have said that the greatest goal of life is to know thyself. The goal of the programmer is to make sure of just the opposite, that the victim does not know themselves. They are trained in techniques to do this. If we understand that the programmer is trained to program the mind to forget itself, then of course it is clear that the therapist needs to help the victim to remember who they are, giving the victim his or her identity back. Countless therapists and ministers have trapped mind control victims within their programming by advising them to let bygones be bygones, let the past and the skeletons of the past be buried, forgive and forget, etc., etc. This traps most of the victim's mind in their programming. Of course, this feels safe for the front alters. After all, who wants to discover the horrors underneath them, that their mind has forgotten? It would be helpful if ministers would remember that God encourages self-examination in numerous scriptures. Whoso loveth instruction loveth knowledge, but he that hateth reproof is brutish. Prov 12:1. The spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching out the innermost parts of his being. Prov 20:27. If we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. 1 Cor 11:31. In other words, if we want to be more than animals, we need to examine ourselves and love to learn. It is God's candle for a man to examine his own innermost parts. And when we find problems with ourselves, we are to deal with them, and then God won't have to. The therapist needs to reverse what the cult has done. Give the victim his or her identity back. Equip his or her consciousness with what a person's mind would normally be conscious of. Give the person back the intelligence that belongs to their entire mind. Equip the person with a love for God's plan for their life and an appreciation for God's design of things. Give the person their life back by letting them know themselves, and if possible, by letting them join into the whole person they were intended to be by the real God in heaven. Interestingly, the programming is not able to snuff out the person's original personality entirely. The programmers prefer to work within the natural abilities of a mind. This is just good common sense. Horse trainers do the same. The trainer uses a standard bred horse which has been bred to pull carriages, to pull carts and buggies, a draft horse to pull farm equipment, and a pinto to ride. If the victim has abilities, he can rightly take ownership of those abilities. It is much more likely that the programmers have suppressed many of the victim's abilities in order to control them. Rather than creating the slave's abilities, the programmers have simply exploited their natural abilities. Typically, a victim has programs to tamper with the senses, to confuse or stop the senses, make the senses feel like they are in some drugged state, to destroy one's sense of balance, cause pain, a sense of hot or cold. To tamper with the spirituality of the victim, to relieve their guilt, to destroy their humanness, to get them to subscribe to occult or atheistic philosophies, to hate God, to lock demons into place. That are codes using alphanumeric words, colors, music, rhymes and sounds. That tamper with memory, cover programs, false histories, hypnotic surgeries. That control with the emotions, so that they can be triggered to be happy, sad, angry, tired, guilty, or afraid. That control actions, such as anorexic no-eat programs, no-talk programs, assassination programs, mute programs, no-cry programs, return to cult programs, sexual programs, specific assignment programs, suicide and self-mutilation programs, trigger other slave programs that control the mind, such as memory flooding, phobias, go insane program, be confused, etc. That control the body, such as heart rate programs, body temperature programs, to prevent helpful medicine from working programs. For a good list of the different programs, see the Universal Function Codes on page 80 of our Volume 2 Formula Book. These programs can be triggered several ways, from both internal and external triggers. By learning that an emotion, thought, or action is a program, the victim gains conscious control over what is happening. The cue may still cause the subconscious desire to fulfill the program, but the victim is beginning to take back his/her life. It becomes harder and harder for the programs to work, when the conscious mind is aware of what they are, and the conscious mind does not want to submit. Memory work on how the program was laid in, and desensitization work will also assist the victim to regain some power. Charting, note-taking, about everything that can be observed about the victim, will assist the support team in the long run. This is nothing more than what was done while they were being programmed. The doctors and programmers during programming expect every little detail to be charted. Charting will also assist with mapping, which is discussed later. Charting will assist the therapeutic team to build a framework to the puzzle they are working on. Don't expect the victim to be able to explain their programming. The mind control programming team has traumatized a child victim enough that by the age of 3 and a half they will cease asking why. Instead, they are taught that everything outside of fantasy is bad, the outside world is bad, they are only to do what they are allowed by the programming team to do. From then on, most of the victim's alters, if not all, will lack the freedom to ask and discover the complexity of what has happened to them. As the reader has seen, programming is designed to manipulate the actions, the body, the emotions, the memory, the mind, the programming, the senses, and the spirituality of the victim. This is why we have decided to call it total mind control. This type of trauma-based total mind control will cause shattering and much damage to the soul, mind, will and emotions. The therapist will have to deal with lots of distortions and fragmentation in this area. It will cause lots of medical damage to the body, for instance weak bowel and bladder control. The medical damage can only be addressed by trained medical persons who are sensitive to the needs of a victim of mind control. Considerable damage is done to the spiritual life of the victim, and the victim will have to take a bath in the redeeming blood of Christ's atoning blood. Many of the words and symbols of Christianity will be difficult for the victim to hear. For instance, the word sealing, blood, and Jesus may have totally different meanings and emotional content to the victim than to non-victims. This can be worked around by experimenting with workable terminology. They will have to relearn who the real God in heaven is, rather than the cult's imitation God that the cult talked about, as well as their misrepresentations. Finally, the support team will have to deal with whatever structured and programmed did is present in the victim. Is it easier to see why we are advocating support teams rather than a lone individual to help the victim? If the spiritual part of the programming, which is the most secret part, which we referred to as gamma programming in our illustrated guidebook, is not addressed, then complex MPD systems will not make much headway against the programming. Many complex MPD systems have worked hard for years and then give up hope due to the slow progress and the lack of any end in sight. Other complex systems have seen dramatic results when deliverance methods freed the deeper sections from demonic bondage. The new freedom allowed them to progress on the other issues that they had gotten bogged down in and made no progress on prior to the deliverance. Obviously, not all programming is the same. It is determined by what group is programming, who their programmer is, what the dissociative abilities of the victim are, and what talents the programmers are wanting to create or exploit. Sometimes a programming cult does not get all the time they desire to carry out the programming. In this case, the programming will be limited. However, in most cases the programmers have as much access to a victim as they want, especially if both parents are in the cult. In cases where the victim does not hypnotize and dissociate easily, their systems will be far less complex. It has been correctly determined by various researchers that a person's ability to be hypnotized is a gauge to determine how much a person will dissociate. However, front alters will be heavily programmed not to allow themselves to be hypnotized, so the gauge will not always work for determining how much splitting the programmers have done. The two abilities, dissociability and hypnotizability, are simply different aspects of the same thing. It does hold true that if the victim is predisposed to dissociate, that the programmers can build more complex structures. If a skilled therapist can get some handle on how dissociative his client is, he can get an early guesstimate on how much splitting and structuring the Illuminati or Illuminati front group may have done to the mind-controlled slave. Protection, spiritual. Before one can see the value of spiritual armor and those things that would protect a person spiritually, one has to be able to understand what is being protected. This book has dealt with how Satan builds his structures within his mind-controlled servants, but what does God build within his people? Satan is a corrupter and an imitator. Knowing that will give the reader a clue that what Satan has designed is a corruption and in part an imitation of the structures God builds. The spiritual armor that God directs godly people to employ are designed to protect the structures that God creates paradise out of. At this point, it would be worthwhile to display the basic structure that God builds within both a person and his body of saints, in comparison to the basic structure that Satan builds within a person, as well as society. These structures are basic patterns that reproduce themselves at different levels, the macro COSM and the microcosm of the spiritual world. The programmed multiple will have a justice system, judge altars, it will have values, satanic and occult knowledge and wisdom, it will have possessions, such as its birthright, their illusion of health, their titles, etc., and it will have its false truths, the programming. The leadership of a system will provide a miniature state with a hierarchical structure run by Lucifer and his internal grand druid council. Within God's children, he builds truth and life. God's true ministers are life givers. That is why Christ said he came to save people, not to judge people. By building consistency in a person's life, God is fashioning that person not to be double-minded, not to be a hypocrite, not to be wishy-washy, not to be undependable, but to be more like himself. God is unchanging. He is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and therefore he treats all people equal. It rains on the just and the unjust. Or in other words, God is equitable. He doesn't really play favorites, but because he is God, he doesn't explain what seems like arbitrary decisions to us. God will build order, justice, life, truth, and equity into his servants. These elements, diagrammed out for the reader on the next page, make up the elements of paradise and the attributes of God as described in the Word of God. These are the elements, the spiritual structures, that the armor of God described in Ephesians 6 are designed to protect. Some people think that spiritual protection comes from prayer. But if we look at the Word of God and also learn from great spiritual warriors, we discover that the spiritual armor that God describes, truth, faith, salvation, etc., are great tools to protect us. For instance, the truth does set a monarch victim free. But it isn't enough to have the truth. The Word of God says only the love of the truth will protect us. See this. For a mind control victim to know that they have salvation, gives them great leverage to defeat the attacks of the enemy. If a victim has an altar or alters who can have total faith in God, and can move forward in that faith will literally become a force field around them that will move the enemy out of the way, and cause them to back off or surrender. Prayer is not the answer in itself, but prayer built upon the structures that God builds in a person, prayer built on love, prayer built on faith, and hope and life and truth, these prayers will have power. From the great reluctance of many church-going people to learn the type of truthful information that our books are revealing, in spite of the horrible truth that these issues affect their lives in big ways, shows that many people do not realize the spiritual protection that truth gives its holder. We are born into a world full of deceptive symbols. It takes a conversion to begin to break away from the deceptions that trap humankind, but many of the churches take their people right back into the same mind traps. Elements of the World System and Its Satanic-Inspired Quest for Utopia. Ordo of Chaos. Pyramids even with three equal dimensions have a bottom and a pointed top. Top rules bottom, bottom support slash protects top. Pyramid with a mirror image equals basic satanic structure. Picture. Elements of God's paradise are the attributes of God which sustain the universe. Four true offices are pillars to this structure. God is the spirit of truth, he serves as the light of New Jerusalem. God is the life-giver, the water and trees of fruit of New Jerusalem. God is the lawgiver, the New Jerusalem has a great wall and order. God is love, our friend, the New Jerusalem has its own glory, warm sun, and worship. God is a consuming fire, a judge, the great white throne of the New Jerusalem. God is unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, treats all equal, it rains on the just and the unjust, in other words, he is equitable. Stability, a cube is solid and balanced. The belt of truth mentioned as spiritual armor in Ephesians 6:3 is like a girdle that pulls and holds things together. Belts or girdles held things together for the ancient warrior, as well as holding the scabbard. The word of God says, gird up your loins. Which means to pull yourself into the wholeness and integrity of God. The belt of truth is more accurately described as the belt of integrity. Integrity means being stable, without being double-minded. Satan divides and conquers. He uses division everywhere to defeat the godly person. Integrity means an individual's private life lines up and equals his public image. There is no duplicity, no division of purpose in this belt. It means the wearer of this belt is solely one-minded toward God. The belt of truth defends God's order of things. The sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. The Spirit reveals to us truth, both the truth of God's Scripture and the truth about other things of God's creation. The sword of the Spirit protects the Bible from being misunderstood. We are to pray that the Spirit of God reveals and teaches us truth. The sword of the Spirit then protects truth. God is truth, so if we seek God, we will find him where truth is. No wonder it says that the truth shall set you free. The unique power of the truth, ye shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. In any type of bondage, if the full truth could be understood by the right persons who need it in that situation, it would make us free. In Romans 1:16, Paul states, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Salvation, and being made free, basically have to refer to the same condition of deliverance from bondage. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, no man cometh unto the Father but by him. The truth and the gospel that says Jesus saves to the uttermost, those that come unto him by faith, are mutually inclusive and if you really know one, you will also know the other. Is the truth impossible to find? In Romans 1 we are told that we are all without excuse because God has given us in nature enough evidence of his power and Godhead that we are automatically responsible for the way we seek after more light or hide in the darkness. The word of God says that men hide from the light because their deeds are evil. Living in the dark makes it easy for the enemies of God to capture the servants of unrighteousness who have yielded their bodies in one way or another to the desires of the fleshly nature with which we were all born. If we didn't die to our old life when we were born again, we are like Mary's brother Lazarus who was raised from the dead, but had to be loosed from the grave clothes in order to walk and carry on life. Some people are still bound in grave clothes and need to be set free. It takes obedience to the gospel to be set free, and it takes some people months or years to understand and accept all the terms of their pardon as purchased by the precious blood of Jesus, and they live in bondage to the extent that they fail to claim all of their spiritual inheritance, and the gifts that come with them. When they learn the whole truth, they find they are set free. Other items of protection. This article has just touched briefly on two of the spiritual armors that the Word of God says will protect us, the belt of truth and the sword of the Spirit. The shield of faith will protect the victim of mind control from the worship of idols, from worshiping the wrong things in our life like our handler, and will protect our true love for Almighty God, our real Creator. The helmet of salvation will protect the victim, when the accuser of the brethren tries to heap guilt and insecurity upon us. It will also help the victim to protect their birthright given to them as a child of God. Each victim as a child of God has a wonderful birthright to some great things, but the enemy will steal it if they don't protect their godly birthrights. Some victims ignorantly given their birthrights away like Esau. As a born-again believer, the victim has a legal position in Christ that makes the person a joint heir to the resurrection, Rom 6:3-11, F2:1-5, and a joint heir to reign with him, 2 Tim 2:12, Col 3:4. The breastplate of righteousness will protect the victim's relationships with their support team, and the world in general. It will mean that they will treat their fellow man correctly in financial dealings, legal dealings, and any other dealing where fairness is involved. The breastplate of righteousness will defend justice and equity. Equity, which is fairness, means treating people equally. This will encourage the programmed multiple to treat people in the same fair way that they want others to treat their system. We have just briefly touched on these spiritual protections. We hope that this will stimulate the reader to search and learn more about these spiritual weapons and how they can protect the victim from the attacks of the enemy. Now, for instance, if the reader listens to a sermon where he is told that spiritual warfare calls for him to reject false values, repent of sin, and resist deception, he will realize the minister is managing to hit upon three of the substitutes for the five elements that make up God's structure. Special situations where spiritual protection is needed. As internal work is done, spiritual protection will be needed to protect the system from the warfare and counterattacks of the internal forces. The victim of mind control will also need protection from astral projections of their master. This protection is provided for by a support person using the principles of the spiritual world to slam the astral body back into its physical body. Spirits of fear, mistrust, contention, suicide, and despondency will try to attack the victim on a regular basis. The victim and the support persons need to be aware of these daily attacks and develop a mindset and a determination to spiritually refuse these spirits. The support person should be gentle but firm in assisting the victim to dislodge and cast out such demonic attacks. All prayer should be grounded upon the structures of God, which are life, order, true love, justice, equity, and truth. God is the life giver, the creator, the healer, the savior, the father, the peacemaker, the consoler, and the sustainer. Our prayers to him should be grounded in the reality that he is all these life-giving roles. This may help you understand what it means to ground our prayers in the structure of life. We are called to imitate God and also be life-givers in the fullest sense of the word. Where will the enemy counter-attack after progress is made? The enemy will send in false teachers, 1 Timothy 4:1-3, or he'll try to give a false reputation to the world by slandering the person before men and before God, Job 1 and 2, as well as other scriptures. He will attack the person's confidence, their beliefs, their relationships, and their walk with God. In other words, if one looks at a cross, one spoke is prayer to God, one spoke is our walk, righteousness, before God, one spoke is our witness to others, and one spoke is our fellowship with others. Satan will attempt to weaken any one of these four arms of the cross. He and his forces, demonic and human, will generally look for and attack the weakest link in our defense. If we think things through, it makes sense that if Satan were to attack God's people, the best place to attack them is in their churches. A fierce war is being waged in the churches today to destroy all true believers. This war is very well conceived and well coordinated. It is not happening by accident. One of the major weapons that the enemy uses is religious spirits of judgment. Judgment brings death. It is one thing to expose evil, so that healing can occur, that is godly. But the religious spirits that judge are out to hurt and destroy. These judgmental religious spirits are out to divide, so that Satan can conquer. We feel safe in saying that until our books came out, including this one, the Christian churches were totally ignorant about multiplicity and what it entails. We have watched many multiples suffer from judgmental spirits in the churches. These religious spirits are not from God, so don't let them hurt your relationship to God. But why can Satan attack? There are a number of spiritual reasons why. First, is that the programmed multiple is traumatized and programmed during their lifetime to create footholds, legal loopholes, that give Satan the legal right to attack. Ephesians 4:27 says, "And do not give the devil an opportunity." The word opportunity in the Greek is topos, which literally means foothold. These footholds are also referred to as strongholds in the mind, 2 Cor 10:4, which are like fortresses that Satan keeps operating in enemy territory that allow him to attack vulnerable lines. They are like secret holes that serpents can live in to crawl out of into your nice garden. The spirit that crucified Jesus was the religious spirit of judgment. It will attack you with a vengeance. The victim and the support team must not allow themselves to become subject to these religious spirits. The judging religious spirits are trying to provoke the person who is the target of their attack. These evil spirits want a reaction from their target. The godly person can do exactly what Jesus did, let these judgmental spirits rant and rave, and after all these antics keep one's peace. The reaction will be, "Aren't you going to do something about this?" Just say, "It's a moot point, it's not relevant. I don't give it credence," and move on. Each victim must seek life-giving answers for their own situation. Don't let the religious spirit of judgment steal you of your chance for life. Just remember Jesus's words, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in." The Pharisees of today will find all the right answers to justify their position. You as a victim must seek truth, you must seek life, you must seek love. Forget these religious men that bind big burdens upon people and strain at gnats. You as a little child, and what programmed multiple isn't mostly a child, are what the kingdom of God is made of. If you retaliate against the Pharisees, then you have lost, because that is what these religious spirits want, is to get you into a battle on their territory. Even if you win that battle, you've lost, because you had to leave your territory, the peace of God, to enter back into Satan's domain. Don't fight religious spirits, they are a sly trick of Satan to get you to step back out of God's domain into Satan's boxing ring. At that point, you will participate in the lie that the boxing match is the real contest. Don't trust in yourself, even if you can win in that boxing ring. If you know that God is with you, stay with Him in peace. Safety issues of slave. This section is an attempt to coordinate information scattered in many different articles and chapters, as well as discuss ideas that come under safety that are not addressed in other places, such as how to work with child victims of mind control. Other articles that pertain to safety include: the Accessing article deals with safety from the abuser's contacts. The Triggers article deals with safety from all the programming and memories that activate irregardless of whether the original abuser is around or not. The Self-Inflicted Harm article deals with safety issues that derive from the victim's own threats to themselves. The Communication and Trust articles deal with the safety of the therapist-recovering slave's relationship. The Deliverance and Salvation articles deal with the spiritual safety issues. The Surveillance article deals with safety issues concerning harassment and continued cult interference in life. The Mazes and Mirror articles deal with the safety issues of tackling particular programming. Safety tips will be discovered scattered through all of our books on mind control. The abuse of a victim is ongoing, unfortunately it was not just yesterday, but is here today. That is why this book's two authors have made a point of referring to victims of mind control as victims, and not as survivors. The word survivor is very popular among therapists, and the word victim will cause some therapists to go into convulsive uncontrollable rage. The word is not popular. But the word survivor comes along with all the denial and whitewash of the establishment therapeutic community, that somehow this abuse happened to a poor helpless child and now that the child is an adult, they have survived this abuse. First, This ignores completely that the Illuminati continue to access and use essentially all mind control victims that are trying to get therapeutic help, and it also ignores the fact that 99% of the alters have no concept that they are an adult, but if anything still see themselves as children. The high percentage of child alters is never realized by novice therapists, because the adults protect and hide them. A safe house is a place where a victim can go to stay from dusk to dawn in safety, or even better, a safe place to live. Generally, when safe places have been discussed, it has been the goal to keep plans discreet and only on a need-to-know basis. A safe house will not take the place of a hospital, but the option of placing victims in hospitals is a very risky last resort. It would be great if safe houses could be set up with qualified therapists and trained volunteers who recognize the unique safety needs of victims. This would give recovering victims an opportunity to gain strength as they fought the internal lies and the dissociation. Such issues as how much does it cost, what does the victim bring, how does one keep a victim from acting out programs, do you force the person to stay if they want to leave, do you have in-house rules, who handles the medication? Can the victim receive visitors? And who and when? What kind of special dietary needs does the victim have? A safe house cannot possibly cover all the safety needs of a victim. The Illuminati have traditionally threatened their families, their pets, their reputations and their jobs. The author has seen the Illuminati make good on some of their threats, but generally they threaten and intimidate more than actually act. A major issue is feeling abandoned and alone. A support person will achieve the best calming effects if they can maintain a constant presence with the recovering victim. When the support person or therapist is absent, life becomes a terrifying experience, and the fear the victim lives in while alone can make a few hours seem like eternity. The safety of child victims. Fritz and this author Cisco have had to resist the opportunity to help some young victims of mind control because we knew that helping them would put their lives at great risk. There are certain ages that if the child or teenager has not progressed to the point that they are expected, they will be killed by the Illuminati. Children who are multiples have treatment needs that are different than adults. The first problem that must be faced is that the child's parents or caregivers should be involved in the treatment, but the odds are extremely high that they are dirty and part of the abuse, no matter how well or to what extent they deny it. It goes without saying that the therapist needs to be able to handle the emotional trauma of helping child abuse victims. It may be harder than working with adults, because the therapist is face to face with the helplessness of the child, who is confronted with a powerful evil system of enormous magnitude. The skilled therapist will study the child's interaction with others, on the playground, with other children, at home, and when the child is alone. They will watch for strange aberrant interaction between the parents and the child. The therapist will also watch the child's eyes to see how they interact with other people, or if the child tries not to look at adults. The child may have a dull, apathetic, dissociative look to their face, or simply a blank look, or a glazed look. Check to see if they have puffy bags or dark eye circles. When the child has suffered the abuse of the trauma-based mind control hallucinations, a desire to hurt themselves, and disturbed responses to heat, cold, pain and enclosures. A multiple will have erratic grades and abilities, their grades may be low compared to their 1.0. And they may be tired or hyper in school. Popular cover stories to cover programming sessions for children are tonsillectomies, especially emergency tonsillectomies. Also, sending the child to specialists may be a cover, or taking the child to a funeral. The child will be shown funeral pictures and told that it was there. They like to isolate the child from playing with other children too. The poor child victim of mind control will not have the words to sort out the coexistent feelings of love and hate for the victim's abusive parents. They also do not have the language capabilities to describe their feelings and emotions. Guilt may simply be expressed as, it just doesn't feel good. If the therapist is going to help a child victim of mind control, they need to communicate to the child that as a big person they will be gentle, but that they have the unchangeable strength to protect the child and care for the child. I will help you be okay, and I will protect you. The therapist should also convey to the child that I know it was not your fault. I am able to hear what you have to say without being wiped out or shattered. We will do this together. I know you are going to be okay. If the child realizes that he or she can be safe with the therapist, the child may begin to warm up to others too. As the child feels valued, it will feel safe enough to talk about things a little. Safety issues, of support team. During the many years that your author Cisco has observed people trying to help programmed multiples, we have seen a range of counterattacks by the world order. Precautions. Find out how the network operates and what organizations are part of it. Fritz has some excellent information on this. Do not trust law enforcement. We have seen victims get conned by seemingly well-intentioned law enforcement people who deal with cults as part of their job. If you feel like our warning is hysteria, then you are welcome to reinvent the wheel. An example of how victims of mind control will be treated is told in the front of Mark Phillips and Kathy O'Brien's book Transformation of America. In the front of their book they provide the business cards of some of the law enforcement people who were dirty and stabbed them in the back as they attempted to get her daughter free and to get justice. Kathy and Mark traveled all over this nation in search of justice. It isn't there. We will not provide a long litany of horror stories, for no amount of proof will convince those who are still trapped in their own mind control that the our judicial system still works for the people. The Illuminati's network is victimizing America at will. Do not trust the establishment media. They are great at manipulating stories to discredit the truth. The institutions that America has trusted in have long been subverted by the Illuminati. The bad news. Typically, the network, what the abusers call themselves, will try to publicly discredit anyone who opposes them. Today, a popular way to do this, is to infiltrate a programmed multiple, who is programmed with an ulterior agenda, into therapy and then take the therapist down with the cry false memories were implanted. The victim needs to be worked with in such a way that they recover their own memories and the therapist has this validated. Several conferences around the country have gone into detail about the ins and outs of legally protecting oneself. Fritz and this author provide our assistance to victims gratis. We suggest that others might consider simply doing this. The therapist may get their office files broken into, and in a few extreme cases the therapists have actually been murdered. Some support people, including therapists, have had their personal lives disrupted. Their spouses leave them, they are poisoned, such as what happened in LA as well as other places, their automobiles break down, sometimes with obvious signs of tampering, and they find opportunities in the world shutting in their faces. The good news. The persecution of good people exposes to the world what is going on. Recently, a person who only half believed our material showed it at the university where they taught. The immediate and overwhelming negative persecution that came was so obviously an overreaction if the material had been false, that the persecution made a believer out of this truth-seeking person. Every time the enemy exposes himself to persecute our side, he exposes himself. In a war, the enemy exposes his position when he shoots at you. You can fool some of the people some of the time, and some of the people all of the time, but you can't fool all of the people all of the time. Procedures for an assassination. The Illuminati members must get the Grand Druid Council's approval for an Illuminati assassination of one of their slaves, etc. Therefore, the Illuminati handlers often get other groups like the Mafia to do the dirty work. In other words, the Illuminati is not just running wild wiping people off the face of the earth. Their control is very planned out and systematic. Up until recently, they had never lost a slave to freedom, so they still don't really consider our side to be a viable threat. While our side painstakingly rescues an individual here or there, they continue to program tens of thousands. They have stayed ahead of their opposition, and even created much of their own opposition. They will take advantage of a person's weak points. They will put a great deal of study into where a person is weak, and take him or her down at that weak point. They will also look for routines. A routine is something that is a natural setup for exploitation. They will also try to divide and conquer. If they can separate a person out and isolate a person, they will go in for the kill.